Looking to catch up on the latest Star Wars books? Try listening to them on audio. Featuring sound effects and music directly from the movies, Star Wars audiobooks are the definitive listening experience. From brand new audiobooks such as Master and Apprentice and Queen's Shadow to our blockbuster movie tie-in editions, you'll have plenty to keep you entertained. If you're attending Star Wars Celebration, visit Penguin Random House Audio at booth 3019 to play audiobook trivia, get free audiobook clips, and more. When you're a Star Wars collector, be it comics, books, or toys, it can be hard to keep track of everything you have. Gemmer is a free app for collectors that helps you solve that problem. Join their Star Wars community where you can easily catalog your collection and show off your amazing stuff to a community of fellow fans. Just go to Gemmer, that's GEMR.com/coffeewithKenobi, to check it out today.
This is Andy Gutierrez from StarWars.com, and you are listening to Coffee with Kenobi with Dan Z. This is the podcast you're looking for.
I've been waiting for Celebration all year long.
Are you ready to celebrate?
Hey, Shitstorm, what do you say? Back to that same old place. Sweet home, Chicago.
Oh, and guess what? This is the podcast you're looking for.
This is James Arnold Taylor, and you're listening to
Coffee with Kenobi. I have a good feeling about this.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to our final day coverage of Celebration Chicago and a recap of the entire experience. I am your host, Dan Z, along with my co-host, Cory Clubb.
Hey there, how's it going?
And Tom Gross.
Hello, everybody.
All right, we're going to talk to you about what we did today and our reflections. So, Tom, why don't you start? Kind of walk us through your day and what you experienced. I mean, we basically broke it up into three different sort of sections, I guess.
All right. Well, I started the day with my final day of trying to get the exclusive Master and Apprentice cover, and I got a really good starting spot. I was just a few people, like, depth-wise back from the entrance to the show floor, so I was feeling really good about getting this. And when they raised the tape, people rushed through. A few people were running to different places, but in all fun and excitement. But I quick walked over to the booth, and I'm sure that would have been a joyous video for someone to watch, but I did not video it. Anyway, I got there, got in line, which had already wrapped around out of the vendor area by the time I'd gotten there, which I was really surprised at. I thought that I was in a really good position. And within, I would guess, about 60 to 90 seconds, a rep from the from Del Rey was walking back saying, guys, we're all out of bracelets. You can, you know, go about your way. Sorry, we're out. And I was shocked because I was told that there were hundreds of these each day to be given out. And so I was disappointed, but you know what? You got to let it roll off you. Wasn't a big deal. I'll still read the book. I'll still buy the book. So I took that opportunity to go. I'd had my eyes on a hat because Corey had purchased a hat from this location, Heroes and Villains. Is that correct?
Right.
And so I walked over there, and there was a short line there. I thought, maybe I'll come back later. But then I discovered that they had a unique exclusive pin. And so I just got in line, just waited about 10 minutes, bought my hat, got a little exclusive TIE Fighter pin, and I was pretty pleased with that. Did not expect it, but that was good. So, I'm sorry, did you want me to keep going, or...
And then we'll talk about our morning, and then we'll bridge into Resistance if you want.
Okay, that sounds... Well, I still have more in the morning, because that was just the start of my morning, because then I did a little walking around, because I've been trying to collect cosplay photos to fill sets of, like, Rebels, Resistance, trying to find those characters, just to give me something to do, something to look for cosplay that was fun. But I then had a photo with Ashley Eckstein. And so I'll give a little story on this. once I got in there, I had a book, her book that's escaping, the title is escaping my mind right now, but I bought it for my daughter and wanted to get a photo with that book because it's really important to my daughter. She loves Ashley Eckstein. So I went in there and they took the photo with the book, and Ashley was so gracious. My favorite part of that area was that there were kids in front of me in the line, and she spent time with those kids. She did not pay attention to the photographer at all and spent extra time with those kids, which I thought was phenomenal. Making those connections, making those young Star Wars fans, you know, love this experience. And so I thought that was a plus on her part. So I got up there and the guy did a quick ready. And so we took the shot and I came around to where you pick up the photos, and my photo didn't show up and my photo didn't show up and my photo didn't show up. And so I told them that, you know, several people have passed that were behind me. And so they discovered that for some reason my photo didn't come through. So I got a ticket to go back, and they brought me in through the back, stopped the line. I went in and to take the photo again, and I said, "I'm sorry, I'm coming back. I must have broke the camera." She says, "Oh no, I'm sure it was me." And I said, "Doubtful." And so he tried to take the picture again, and the camera froze on him. And so I got to have a few words with Ashley, which was fantastic. And so I told her, I said, "My daughter loves this book, and I'm so thankful for you for writing this book." And she said, "Oh, that's so great. Has she read it?" And I said, "Well, she's gotten through the goals part." And she said, "Well, what is her goal?" And I said, "She would really love to be a YouTuber." And Ashley turned and looked at me and looked me right in the eye and said, "You tell her that when she posts her first, or that I'm so looking forward to seeing her first video." And I was like, "Oh, that was such a cool thing to say. And I can't wait to tell my daughter." And then they said, "Ready," and took the photo. And it's a great photo. I'm so happy with that. So after that, I walked over to the Star Wars stage show. Star Wars show stage and watched the remainder of the Phantom Menace 20 anniversary panel, which I'm sure you guys will talk about. So,
yeah, for me, I was lucky enough to get into the lottery for the Wind Trust panel for Phantom Menace 20th anniversary. So we got in there, and what's unique about that? Maybe most people don't know the difference between Wind Trust and like the Overflow stage. Was Wind Trust actually has some vending and you know, some concessions there. You can actually get and eat in your seat, which is, I thought was kind of a nice little plus. I ended up getting some nachos, which is my breakfast food. So I was like, nachos for breakfast. That's something unique.
I didn't know that. That
was fun. So then obviously waited a couple hours for that panel to start. Reflections on that panel. It was cool to see they actually played the first trailer that they put out for Phantom Menace, which really got me, because I was like, oh yeah, I totally remember this now, and how excited that being when that first came out, how, you know, it was just like, and those the words rolling up on the screen, every generation is a hero, and I was like, hey, this is just like the one we saw on Friday for the Skywalker, the Rise of Skywalker, thank you, misplacing my words, but I was like, okay, so this is a nice little transition, you know, watching the last trailer, but now I'm watching the first trailer, so this is really cool. So then they brought out the ILM folks that had worked on the film, and like kind of did a recap of like 20 years later, what their positions they were in now, and that was kind of cool. I would like to see that back behind the scenes stuff. Different types of modeling was kind of new. Technology was brand new. That was kind of neat to talk to them. The sound was cool, and then they let them off to the side there and brought in some of the actors, Ray Park, and Ian McDermott, and I've never seen them on a stage before. But I've heard such good things, so I was excited to talk to, you know, hear their stories and hear them talk about their experiences of being on the set for the first time, and their relationship was really cool. And Warwick Davis was hosting everything. He's always a great host. They brought Ahmed Best, and then they brought I'm blanking on the name, C-3PO.
Anthony
Daniels, thank you. And that was all great. They obviously, the cast gets along very well. They're very excited to see all the fans, and excited to celebrate 20 years of Phantom Menace. Then they had a short clip, maybe Dan will talk more about his thoughts on this, but George Lucas had a short clip of, you know, obviously thanking fans and just saying how much he appreciates that film and his favorite character is Jar Jar Binks. He put that out there again, and that he would just, he said, it's all for you, obviously speaking to the fans, and thank you so much for being fans. So I think it was a really nice little side piece for George to have a short video there. And then they recapped, brought the ILM folks back out, and kind of did an overall, like, you know, history of what their professions have been, their careers have actually been for the span of 20 years, which I thought was kind of cool, all their accolades and what they've been doing. And obviously they're all been successful and moved on to the franchise and done more Star Wars stuff. So it was a really cool panel to see. I was glad to be able to be part of it.
I thought it was, I too agree that when they started with a trailer that was really, really nostalgic and nice, and it even looked like it was 20 years old, you know what I mean? Which is weird, because when it first came out, it certainly looked fresh and brand new. I actually learned some things about The Phantom Menace I didn't know. I didn't realize that Ray Park had a cameo as a soldier, a Naboo soldier, and I didn't realize that Sebulba's engine was a Ferrari with a hole punched in the muffler. I thought that was so cool, and that sound has always been one of my favorite sounds. In fact, Mason and I have talked about that before. So that was cool. McDiarmid is really quite a personality on stage. I think he's really endearing, and having Ray Park come out and do his pose and stuff was insanely cool. So I enjoyed it. It was nice. It made me smile. I mean, hopefully people didn't expect they were going to announce a sequel, because they already have one. It's Attack of the Clones. So there was nothing new to really report on there.
Guess what, we're at the sequel.
Yeah, but other than that, besides the nostalgia, I thought they would do a little more with him at best. He was sort of like there, but he wasn't a focal point. And you also wonder how much of that play tension between Anthony Daniels and Warwick Davis is real.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's hard to say. Yeah, but there's clearly some history there. But it was certainly entertaining to watch. I'm not going to say I was underwhelmed with the panel, but I mean, it was fine. It was fine. I mean, in retrospect, would I have missed it? Maybe. But I'd never seen a lot of those people in the flesh before. I haven't seen Ray before, of course, but not anyone else. Not really Ian McDiarmid. And so I liked seeing him. So it was a fun atmosphere. It's fun to celebrate a movie that has been much maligned. I enjoyed that. After that, basically, there was a lot of walking around. Before the Phantom Menace panel, I went into the Celebration store. I was one of the first people in there. I got pretty happy about that, and some of the stuff was pretty pickling. Some of the t-shirt sizes weren't there. I really wanted that Rebel shirt. Totally sold out. The Rise of Skywalker shirt totally sold out the day before. So I got a Star Wars show hat, just because I like everything with the Star Wars show on it. I just think it's just a fun thing, and there are good people working on it. We got some Celebration t-shirts for some people, and that was cool. Then Tom and I were walking around after, and we ran to Matt Martin. And I just seen Matt in passing, and it was cool. He said, man, I haven't seen you the entire Celebration. I know it's just crazy because everybody's running all over the place. We talked about his conversation with Josh Gad and how Josh was ribbing him on the panel for Galaxy's Edge, and we had fun with that. That was one of my favorite parts, actually, is seeing him tease Matt in that video with Josh Gad. And that was just a really fun thing and just made me smile. It was very entertaining, which is nice. And then after that, basically, there wasn't a ton of time. I got to talk with James Burns a little bit at Jedi News. I got to talk with Mark Newbell, too, from Fantatrax. Love those guys. Never get to talk to them enough. But I think that's one of the main themes I'm noticing in Celebrations over and over again. You're definitely going to see people and have some time to say hello and shake their hand or what have you. But as far as directly getting a chance to spend quality time together, you really got to go out of your way to schedule it and make it happen, because there's so many people you want to spend time with. And it's very, very hard to do. So after that, Tom and I went to the Resistance panel, which we'll talk about a little bit. And then, Corey, what did you do?
Yeah, so it's one of those things we talked about a little bit, even today, was the fact that you feel like you haven't really got to everything. And I feel like the show floor, I really respect the show floor, because in Chicago they had such a huge presence, a great atmosphere for it. It was all spread out. They had plenty of space to walk around. I didn't feel like I was all cramped in. I could get to all the vendors I needed to go see. And just walking around, kind of looking at random little stuff. And actually, on the last day, I found that a lot of vendors had sales. So that's a little piece of advice there. So if you're looking to get something, maybe if you're going for all the days, the last day is when usually they have a lot of sales going on. So that was kind of cool to see that. Looked some art prints and stuff. I'd seen walking through, but never really got a chance to like look up close and personal. And just looked around some other vendors to see what's uniqueness of what's out there and see what other collectors are looking at and such. And looked at some other cosplay stuff, and it's just kind of fun to be in the ambiance of the show floor and the Star Wars show floor as well. Always having characters. Ian McDermott came back out and did a short little piece, and so it was cool to see kind of that as it kind of was in all the flux and flowing.
So the Star Wars Resistance panel, we walked in there and found some seats that were decent. It was not a full panel by any means, but it was a good, lively crowd. And the cast came out, and boy, here's what stood out to me about them, as well as an observation of the Episode 9 panel and the Clone Wars panel and the Resistance panel, was how each one of these groups of Star Wars voice actors and actors, they all work together. They really have a different types of senses of connections. I really felt like the Episode 9 cast really has this like friends type of relationship, kind of a flirty, palling around kind of relationship that I feel reflects a lot of the early original trilogy cast from the 1970s and the way kind of they palled around and had those relationships. And then, you know, the Clone Wars has this very mature relationship because they've been together for so long. And then this Resistance cast, man, they just have so much fun, and they have so many connections. And what's interesting is the two clowns on the stage are the ones that the young ones look up to, Bobby Moynihan and Donald Faison. So you got these two clowns who are great, and I don't say clowns in a negative way. I mean, in the most positive way. We all know who, you know, what they're like. And then, so you've got this very young cast, and they just have a love of the story. And, you know, I love the fact that they are a part of the Star Wars story. And so, you know, they had talked about season one and some of their favorite moments. And of course, the director and the writer are out there as well sharing. And that's another...
Justin Ridge,
that's right. And here's another aspect about all three of those that I mentioned is their respect for the directors, but also a sense of that they're part of the team. It's not like the directors are the directors and you just do what they say. You know, there's a mutual respect of friendship and direction in that. It's really neat. I love that aspect about the Star Wars casts. And then they started talking a little bit about season two, and they said, and I'm always forgetting the name of the mechanic. Her name is Tam. That's right. They said, well, will we ever see Tam again? Because she's been taken by the First Order. And
taken is an interesting word.
Oh, she does go. Yeah, you're right. You're right. She goes willingly. She goes with the First Order, and we wonder, will we see her again? And so, to make the long story short, they said, well, let's take a look at episode one of season two.
Yeah, they said, not a trailer, not a clip. Let's watch the whole episode. I kind of figured they would do that. I almost thought they would with the Clone Wars, too. But they're obviously saving that because Disney Plus. That was a really fun treat. No, and I actually kind of like Taken as a word choice because she was taken, like, she was tricked. I mean, she thinks she's doing the right thing. I won't spoil what happens at the end of that first episode. Boy, it's powerful.
Oh,
symbolic. Yes. And it certainly revolves around Tam. There's no doubt about that. So, tell you what, let's go ahead and take a break. When we come back, we're going to talk about the rest of our day and share our thoughts overall on Celebration Chicago. This is Coffee with Kenobi.
This is Vanessa Marshall, and you're listening to Coffee with Kenobi.
Looking to catch up on the latest Star Wars books? Try listening to them on audio. Featuring sound effects, top-notch narrators, and music directly from the movies, Star Wars audiobooks are the definitive listening experience. From Luke Skywalker to Kylo Ren to Admiral Ackbar, you'll recognize all of your favorite characters. Listen to movie tie-ins like The Last Jedi and The Force Awakens, to book titles such as Master and Apprentice and Pirate's Price. Don't forget to pre-order Dooku, Jedi Lost, available only on audiobook, on sale April 30th. With Star Wars audiobooks, you'll have plenty of Star Wars listening to keep you entertained. If you're attending Star Wars Celebration, visit Penguin Random House Audio at booth 3019 to play audiobook trivia, get free audiobook clips, and more. For most of us here at Celebration, enjoying Star Wars isn't a hobby, it's a lifestyle. If you're a Star Wars fan, there's a good chance you're also a collector, be it toys, books, comics, or clothes. But how do you keep up with all the announcements and make sure you get the things you want? How do you keep track of what you have? And how do you show off your awesome collection to people who are just as passionate as you? That's where Gemra comes in. It's the best app for organizing and displaying your collections, connecting with other Star Wars fans, and discussing all things happening a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. Download the app for free here, or go to Gemra, that's gemr.com/coffeewithkenobi, to join their Star Wars club today. Who is R2-D2? What is the Sith? Find out all of this and more by visiting DK at booth 3018 at Star Wars Celebration. Stop by the DK booth for DK author signings, giveaways, and a few exciting surprises. You'll have opportunities to meet Christian Blauvelt, Cole Horton, Liz Heineke, and Jason Fry. As a world leader in illustrated reference guides, DK publishes highly visual, photographic nonfiction for adults and children, and their Star Wars books are no exception. Packed with stunning images and engaging text, DK's Star Wars books are perfect for fans of all ages. Visit online at DK.com or in person at Star Wars Celebration to start reading now, and be sure to follow DK on social media for a full schedule. We are back. One quick thing I want to say about the Resistance panel. Tom, you nailed it. That cast, they're really charming. They have a ton of fun together. They do kind of seem to mirror their characters quite a bit. You know, I don't know if we're just sort of classically conditioned to feel that way because of what the Rebels cast was like. But I think this is even more so because of the spirit and the joy and the exuberance of how they kind of interact with each other and with the scenes and moments and their clear joy at being a part of the Star Wars universe and just at watching that episode because they hadn't seen it either. Bobby Moynihan in particular is a ton of fun with it. Has his face on him. He's just like, there's a reason his name is Hype. I mean, he gets that ball rolling. He's a great fun. So after that, we tried to go on the show floor, and we really didn't make it there. We ate, and then we had to get going for my mythology panel, which, as I said on the panel, Clayton, of course, was supposed to do the behind-the-scenes section, but because he got assigned somewhere else by ABC News, he wasn't able to stay for Celebration, which was too bad. So we had some things that we had to change up. And so I'll let you guys kind of talk about it first, but basically, it was a long day. It was a very long Celebration, and I was pretty tired. I was pretty wiped out. I didn't have a ton of sort of energy, but I knew that I was on a Celebration panel, and I wanted to bring my best, and I just wanted to try, to have something different. So we walked down into where the room is, and for some reason, I was expecting the Star Wars University stage to be kind of small, like smaller than the podcast stage. But it was bigger, and it was packed. I mean, I'm talking like 20 minutes before I even got there packed. There were tables set up, and people could sit at them. It was sort of like a college classroom kind of an atmosphere. Ultimately, people were standing in the back as well. I could not believe the amount of people. And I actually thought at first, am I in the wrong room? But I wasn't. And so it was go time, and I was looking around, and I pretty much decided, you know what, since Clayton isn't here. Chris Taylor was actually going to pinch hit for him, but he wasn't able to either because he had to catch a plane as well. I thought, I'm just not going to address the behind-the-scenes stuff too much today because that's not my forte right now, but the mythology aspect is. So I'm just going to teach this like it's a class, and we're going to have a ton of fun. I'm going to try to get people involved and just see where it goes. And I was incredibly, incredibly happy. I want to thank everybody, by the way, for coming out.
And it was actually cool because a lot of people were there. We're not listeners, regular listeners of Coffee with Kenobi. So that means there's an opportunity to reach new people, and I thought that was very exciting.
Well, you sure gave them reason to want to listen to Coffee with Kenobi, Dan, because you knocked the ball out of the park on that panel. I was really happy with the turnout that you got, especially considering, you know, the closing ceremonies had started a half hour before your panel even happened. But, yeah, and I ran around with a mic taking questions for you, and there were people across the back, up the sides, about halfway through the room, sitting on the floor, and, you know, most rows had most chairs filled, so you had a nice crowd. And it was not just a sleepy crowd just holding on to the end of Star Wars Celebration. You had an inquisitive and well-listening crowd. They were, you know, I could tell by watching them, because, again, I was walking around the room, taking the mic, lots of hands going up when you gave them opportunity to answer questions, lots of people, you know, giving those cues that they're listening, like the nodding of heads and turning and saying something to their neighbor and agreeing and stuff like that. And it was really well done, and I think you did a great job on that panel. Of course, it's your, you know, that's your jam. And so you put it right out there and impressed a large group of people.
Thank you.
Yeah, I totally agree with all that. I mean, that's the thing we were saying is we kind of talked to this panel before, and we knew that Clayton wasn't going to be able to make it, and Chris kind of had to catch a plane, like we said. And I kind of turned to Dan. I was like, so I guess you're just doing this one? I mean, like, just going to roll with it? And he's like, I guess so. And I said, you know, he said, well, I might call you guys up to, like, maybe interview me or something like that. It'd be kind of cool. Ask some questions about mythology. He had some slides ready to go. I was like, okay, we can make this work. No big deal. Think on our feet. And like you said, we walked in the room, and it was packed. I mean, we all kind of looked at each other like, I did not expect this at all. And it was really cool. I think it was cool to see the great turnout. And then, like you said, the way that Dan put it together was like he was teaching. It was like I felt like I was sitting in a classroom style because he approached the topics in a way, like, inquisitive way, right? It wasn't just like, here's what I know, I'm going to spit it out at you. It was like, hey, here's some stuff about mythology. Here's some takeaways. What do you guys think about this? Where's mythology come from? Let's just shout some answers. And that's kind of get that Q&A session going right away. And then people were coming up to the front and getting on the microphones and being part of the show. And it was just great involvement. A lot of folks were raising hands. I mean, I saw numerous folks were raising their hands. Just one, like, they realized, oh, okay, I can be part of this. This is cool. And we realized we needed a microphone, man. So Tom was on it and ran around grabbing people. And it was great to see that happen. And the slides were going through as far as the questions being, the topics being posed. And everyone was totally engaged. I mean, they're laughing the jokes. They were kind of like, when you would kind of like realize something, you'd make a fact around mythology and how it ties into Star Wars, the whole room was kind of going, oh. And I found myself going, oh, didn't think about it that way, or I hadn't seen that before. So it was really cool to see you and your element. Obviously, you're made for something like this. But I think your approach made it all the best way it could be. Because, I mean, aside from maybe doing a different way where it would have been more of a back-and-forth conversation with another host, which would have been fine, I think, as well. But I think the crowd involvement, along with your teaching style, along with just being able to keep it open, an open-form style, really made the whole thing come together and made it a great success.
Well, thank you, guys. That really means a lot to me. And I'm glad you got to be there because, I mean, you're my guys, right? And that's... We support each other and build each other up, and I really appreciate that. It was very fun. It was very engaging. And originally, I thought, well, those guys aren't there. Like you said, we'll just interview each other and this and that. And you both had said to me separately, let's not make this a Coffee with Kenobi thing, which I thought was very selfless and an interesting approach. And I thought, well, yeah, that could almost look like I'm trying to sneak out an extra podcast stage appearance. And I wasn't. I really wanted to make it about the topic because I'm very passionate about this topic. It's my two big loves. And when I saw that entire room, I thought, okay, I'm just going to teach. And you even said, I think you said to me, didn't you, something, Tom, like, do you need me? And I said, you know what, I'll call you up at the end if I think we need to go there. But I think I'm just going to teach this class. Yeah.
Were you going to... It's
a good choice. No, I'm just agreeing with you.
Okay, cool. So that's kind of how that was. Then it was over. We talked to people. We told Dennis goodbye. Talked to LJ Souter. Some other people came up. And wonderful. Again, thank you so much for everybody's support. Not only of the Mythology panel, but for a podcast stage appearance for the Covering Star Wars. For coming up and greeting us and chatting with us throughout the entire experience. It was pretty great. So let's shift gears, guys, and just hit our celebration highlights, what we liked, maybe what didn't work as well, and we got another celebration coming next year. Who wants to start?
We can start.
All right.
We do it like a countdown, or just going to talk about...
Kind of just free form, whatever.
Sure, yeah. Overall, just having the convention in Chicago was a blast. It was good for us to be kind of on our own turf. It felt good. I didn't feel like I was kind of in a random city, which is kind of fun, too, to get to know a new city. But having it in Chicago felt like we were kind of playing in our own backyard, and we didn't have to worry about necessarily transportation a whole lot. I felt that was really smooth. Most of the weather for most days were pretty good. I mean, I don't think it was bad other than Sunday, and the snow kind of swept in. And there were some mixed results around that. Certainly, no one likes it to be cold, but also a lot of folks from the West Coast enjoyed it because it was basically the first snow they've ever seen. Or, you know, another time that they've never seen that much snowfall come in, and that's unique for them. So it was part of their experience of celebration, obviously the Midwest and Chicago itself. So that's pretty fun. I liked having that. I liked having all the newness. I felt the whole weekend was a lot of new things. We had obviously episode 9, the title Rise of Skywalker. We had the Mandalorian panel. We had the Galaxy's Edge reveals. We had new seasons of Clone Wars and Resistance. And then we also kind of looked back on a couple of things, along with Clone Wars, looking back on that. Also looking back on 20th anniversary for Phantom Menace. Those are the kind of the big hitters, right? I thought that was really all well done. I mean, I never felt like any panel was like, oh, this is not, they don't need to make this a panel. I felt bored or disengaged. One thing I will say that it was difficult was once you kind of wrapped up one of the larger panels, it was about like noon or 12:30 or so, and you either had to make a choice to like skip a panel or kind of try to get into another panel while you're either getting a poster or a t-shirt or... just trying to get around the place. It was so large. It was a great venue because it was the space, but you had a long, long time to walk to get to the next place you wanted to get to, and you might have missed out on a certain panel you'd wanted to go see. So you got to pick and choose either leaving the panel you're in early or getting over there and kind of make choices. I think that's typical of a convention like this, but maybe that could have been handled a little differently in spite of time of sorts. I also felt like some of the panels, lotteries, I think the lottery was a good system to try out and see how it went. But I think some of the panels that were opened for lottery, there were open seats all over the place. So I thought, like, well, did this lottery really go through? Did people just not show up? What's the deal? So, I mean, a lot of people had kind of hem and hawed over the fact they didn't get anything. And some of the seats were, a lot of seats were open from what I could see, you know, here and there and such. So... maybe a better effort on that part, but lo and behold, I think the floor was the best place to be able to hang out. The cosplay was awesome. I mentioned to somebody that I've never seen this much cosplay in my entire life. It was like every other person was a cosplayer and walking around and being gracious and having a good time. And I like the way that the Star Wars show stage was. It was like a 360 stage. You could walk right up to it and see the whole stage. You didn't have to like really kind of, you know, fight for a space. I mean, it was full, but they had plenty of space to walk up and actually giant screens and see it from far off to see, oh, who's up there now? There's a bunch of cheering. Kind of look at the screen and see, oh, I'm going to go check it out or maybe not. Plenty of vendors to check out items. A lot of presence of other businesses and corporations kind of hawking their goods and talking about all the stuff that's coming out. I feel like I didn't do enough like I don't call them mini panels, but little smaller panels, behind the scenes stuff or publishing stuff that I wanted to get to, just because time wouldn't allow or we needed a break. So other than that, I think the whole experience was fantastic. I think we mentioned earlier, even on our podcast, it was the most fun to see fans and friends again and hang out with these guys and definitely make some memories and have some fun and joke around and turn off our day-to-day lives for a weekend and just kind of soak up the Star Wars and reinvigorate our fandom and definitely go home and happy.
Well said, Corey. That is fantastic. And I have to say, as we are heading home and almost there, I am leaving my first celebration filled with joy. I cannot even believe that. I mean, I am so tired and I'm so exhausted and I really don't want to go to work tomorrow. I love my job, but let's just be honest. But I am heading home with so much joy in my heart, really invigorated and validated on the work that we do on Coffee with Kenobi, as well as just this is a great story. This is a great fandom. This is, it's all just, I just have so much belief in everything that's happening in Star Wars right now after being there. From everything from the level of the engagement of the performers who perform and put on this story for us, that they love the story as much as we do. You know, they're there to earn a dime and they're there to do their job, but it's love that is why they do it, not because they have to do it. Same thing with the authors. You know, we had an opportunity to meet with several authors and talk to them, some in depth, some just very short conversations. But those guys love this story too, as much as we do. And so it's really like Star Wars is being created by the fans of Star Wars for fans. And That was really an eye-opener for me and just made me feel really good about the stuff that we do, as well as just that I'm so happy to be a part of this this whole Star Wars fandom. Another highlight for me, logistically, I thought the lottery went really well. And that's coming from someone who I didn't get much of anything from the lottery. In fact, the two things I got... I unfortunately couldn't take advantage of because I had other obligations during those times, but I was fine with that. You know, being able to watch it on my phone or go to the Star Wars show stage, which is a highlight for me, Corey, just like with you. You know, I love the setup of it. It was accessible, you know, 99% of the time, and that 1% of the time was during the Episode 9 panel. So, hey, if that's the only thing I couldn't get to see on the Star Wars show stage, well, so be it. We had a great time and a unique experience, Corey, watching in our phones tucked away and a part of the show floor, and I'll never forget watching that Episode 9 panel that way. And let's just be honest, for me and my first time meeting everybody was such a big thing. And everything from meeting the celebrities, Ian McDiarmid, Ray Park, and Ashley Eckstein, as well as the authors and you know, the people that work on the companies that put out product for us to enjoy and help to create our fandom a little bit more, all the way down to our listeners and just other people that we had the opportunity to meet standing in line. The very first day in the show store line, Corey and I were sitting there and we struck up a conversation with a guy from New Jersey and we talked to him the whole time, from everything from Star Wars to sports to you name it. We covered the gambit, and it was just, and the reason that was so easy is because whoever you're sitting next to, whoever you're standing next to, you can always say, "So what do you love about Star Wars? What brings you here?" You know, all of that kind of stuff, which you can't do in too many other places in an experience like that. So I could go on and on and on, and I know that you probably don't want to hear every little minutiae detail of my experience, but those are the highlights, and I walk away hoping and wishing that in 2020 I'll be able to go to Anaheim, because this is an experience that, quite frankly, it will be very easy to come to want on a very regular basis.
No, I love hearing every detail that both of you get to experience, because one of the things that was, I guess, was a little surprising, but I guess maybe not, was that even, like, the three of us, we spent a lot of time together, but there were times when we didn't, because, well, I mean, we had different things we were sort of interested in or pulled in different directions, but it was still all part of the joy of the experience, because we get to get back together and share what happened and share what we got to see. Like when Tom told us today about meeting Ashley Eckstein, that was a great story.
Yeah.
You know, those are the fun things that I think make this special. We all have unique stories from this event that last a lifetime and so much more. I love this celebration. I've been saying it's my favorite one. I feel like I don't know if it's my favorite one. It might be tied for my favorite one because the Anaheim one was really special that we did in 2015, because that was the first one we did as Coffee with Kenobi. But like you guys said, this was Chicago. This is our hometown. What I thought was fascinating, endlessly fascinating, was that even though I knew it was Chicago, and I've been to Chicago a million times, I felt like it was just a celebration. I didn't feel like I was in a city or a place. I felt like I was in a state of mind, which was celebration, and just celebrating the joy of that with my great friends. Some people on Patreon saw this already, but the three of us, especially late at night, had the most fun. We laughed so hard and so frequently, kept each other up laughing or goofing around or being silly, and it was just so fun. I don't know how many times I laughed hard. I had heartburn or I was crying with laughter. Yeah, it was just unbelievable, like so many silly private jokes and all kinds of things that were just tremendous. I also want to say Lisa Dullard, we got to hang out with Lisa, and that was a real joy for me. I haven't seen Lisa in, I think she said, 10 years.
Yeah.
And these guys got to meet her for the first time, so we got to spend some time with her. She really is the unsung hero of Coffee with Kenobi. Could not be sweeter or more charming. And she seemed to have a ball, too. Got to meet Eunice. Got to do a lot of great stuff. Got to fly the Solo flag because she's Solo, a Star Wars Story's number one fan. And that was just great for me to see that through her eyes, as was it great to see it through your eyes, Tom, because this was your first celebration as well. The podcast meetup might have been the ultimate highlight because there were so many people we got to spend time with and talk to and laugh with. The panels were great that I got to be a part of. The podcast stage with James Earl Taylor and Catherine Tabor showing up and surprising us was wonderful. Episode 9 stuff and seeing that trailer for the first time. And I think this should cement, at least it certainly cements for me, as if there was never any in doubt, because there wasn't. I love that the first time I got to ever know the title of Episode 9 wasn't on a tweet or a text, but at the end of the trailer for the new movie. That was so powerful and poignant, and everyone reflecting on that was just so, so great. Well, we're almost close to home, and I'm sure there's a lot more we can say, and I know we will on Pour Over in future Coffee with Kenobis. But, yeah, for now, I think that's going to do it for our celebration coverage. Now, we're still going to release the audio of the Covering Mythology panel and the covering Star Wars panel and the Mythology panel. But guys, thank you so much for making Celebration Chicago so amazing and special for me. Your support, your friendship, and just spending time with you guys is one thing that I'm truly going to miss. I'm going to miss a lot of stuff, but being able to hang out with you bozos every day has been a real joy. So thank you so much. Anything else you want to say before we turn off the mic?
I'm ready for some sleep.
No, this has been a great opportunity, and I'm so happy that I was able to join Coffee with Kenobi and the Celebration podcast stage and going together, and yeah, it was awesome.
Well, on behalf then of myself, Tom Gross, and Cory Clubb, thank you so much, everybody, for joining us on Celebration Chicago. As always, so much more to come. Get some rest, and we will see you next time. This is the podcast you're looking for.
Looking to catch up on the latest Star Wars books? Try listening to them on audio. Featuring sound effects and music directly from the movies, Star Wars audiobooks are the definitive listening experience. From brand new audiobooks such as Master and Apprentice and Queen's Shadow to our blockbuster movie tie-in editions, you'll have plenty to keep you entertained. If you're attending Star Wars Celebration, visit Penguin Random House Audio at booth 3019 to play audiobook trivia, get free audiobook clips, and more. Finding a place where you can be as passionate as we are about Star Wars can be tricky. But there's an app called Gemmer that was built just for collectors and fans to come together and hang out. It's like your virtual Star Wars celebration every day. Gemma makes it easy to connect with people who care as much as you do in their Star Wars club. It's like your virtual Star Wars celebration every day. You can find the Gemma app in your app and Play stores for free, or go to Gemma, that's GEMR.com/coffeewithKenobi. Check it out today.